So what am I going to talk about? First, I'm going to tell you a little bit about SimpleReach and what we do. I'm going to give you a couple of definitions, talk to you about some of the data stores, tell you how we got to polygluttony as part of our sort of MO at SimpleReach, tie it together, and hopefully there'll be time for some questions. So what is SimpleReach? SimpleReach is a social intelligence tool for content creators. We track all sorts of social actions in real time from all over the web. We're talking likes, tweets, digs, Reddits, really anything that constitutes a social action. So how big are we? Well, this is an example dashboard, so you can sort of see what some of our customers look at. All these things you're looking at in real time, we see approximately 100 million events a day, and you know that's growing every day, which actually tracks to about 500 million page views a month. And again, we're growing every day. So anybody who has any sort of content, a blog, video, whatever it is, you can come check us out, and we can help you track your social media. So what's polyglot persistence? Polyglot persistence, just like polyglot programming, is all about choosing the right persistence option for the task at hand, otherwise known as the right tool for the job. Why should you use that? Well, sometimes the right tool for the job involves heavier read load. Sometimes it involves heavier write load. Sometimes you're very balanced. Sometimes your data relationships may be less important or more important. It really varies depending on your workload. Different aspects of each of your system may have different requirements than other aspects of your system. So you need to really be aware of the requirements, both storage, both read and write. There is no one size fits all for data. There's a ton of tools out there. I mean, most of you guys and gals out there, like, you guys know what's out there. You could try DynamoDB, Cassandra, InfoBright, Redis, you know, MemSQL. Like, there's everything's out there. You just got to know what's good. You just have to know what's good for you and what each one is good at. Some of them are free. Some of them cost a little bit of money. But what you have to remember is that just because something is free to use doesn't necessarily mean it's free. There's always a cost associated, whether it's learning the actual data store itself or the tools around it or whether it's building the tools that go with it. Everything will come at a cost. You just have to decide, again, what that cost is going to be for you. There's also a ton of languages out there. Some of them, again, work better with other data stores. Some Java data stores like Cassandra work better with Java as the language in the front end. Sometimes it might be Python. Sometimes it might be Node. Again, it's what works well for you, what you know, and what can do the best, what your company's competencies are in. So when you start out building your systems, you want to take the easiest approach, right? You want to do the first thing that's going to bring you to that plateau, the first spot that is going to allow you to move your product and your organization forward. You want to have scale in mind. You want to know what it's going to look like when you get there, but you may not always be ready. You may not always be able to prepare the way you want to prepare. But then when you get there, you really have to know what tools are available to help you either change over to the proper tools or to continue on the current path and expand your tool set. So how did we do it at SimpleReach? When we started, we just used Ruby and Mongo, and that was actually a really good setup for us. But as we started to grow, we realized that that wasn't going to be the eventual solution. The eventual solution had to be something where we could ingest a lot more data, we could segment our workloads. We actually had a lot of requirements that we had to be aware of. So what do we look like now? Well, now we use a couple of different languages. We use Ruby and Rails as our front end. We use Node.js to handle a lot of our edge collection servers. We use Python to do a lot of our offline work. And in terms of data stores, we have four primary data stores. And you'll see, I know that there's five here, but we recently made a decision on dropping one of them, which I'll talk a little bit more about in a moment. So why do we use Cassandra? Well, Jonathan talked about it a little bit earlier on. We have a large data ingestion. We have a lot of data that we ingest, and we need to do it at high volumes. So Cassandra allows us to write to any node, and because of that, we get a great distribution of data. It allows, really fast writes to many locations, and because it's eventually consistent, we can write anywhere, and the data will be available to us. Cassandra allows us to group our queries by the event type. So if we want to see all tweets for a particular article, we can say, give us all tweets for this article that happened between time A and time B, all page views that happened between time A and time B. We can even break it down further if we want, all tweets by a particular user. Anything that's like that, because you can group your columns within rows, Cassandra's actually really good for our use case. The last thing that Cassandra's really good at for our use case is that you can run range queries in Hive. You don't have to run, this is actually coming in the next version of DataStax Enterprise, but you don't have to run the Hive query across the entire column family, which is important for us because the column family that we run our Hive queries against is really, really large. Really, really large for us, which is a few terabytes. So we use Mongo as well. Why do we use Mongo? Mongo has incredibly fast atomic increments, especially from Node.js, which is what handles our atomic increments. Node.js is native JSON. Mongo is native BSON. So when you run an atomic increment, drops it down to the wire in BSON, fires it across the wire, and you don't have to worry about the response. You don't have to worry about error checking. Those increments are incredibly fast. The other thing that Mongo is good at is because of those increments being incredibly fast and you don't have to wait for the response, as you partition out and create multiple shards, those increments become faster as the increments spread across more partitions. It's also got a great ORM. Mongo ID, which is what we use at SimpleReach, is just like Mongo Mapper, a fantastic ORM that comes with that allows you to use Rails with a NoSQL database and allows you to grow in a way that sometimes MySQL can be or Postgres could be somewhat limiting. The other thing that Mongo allows us to do is for that real-time dashboard that I showed you before, it allows us to do a pub/sub model. And we know that the documents that we're storing are going to be persisted in a durable fashion, whereas with Redis, where you can do a similar pub/sub model, not everything is as durable. You have to pay the price for durability, which is those writes to disk. I believe they're called AODs. So Redis also has a bunch of things that work out really well for us. It supports hundreds of thousands of transactions a second. It's a great caching engine because you can do TTLs, and even though Cassandra can do TTLs, Redis allows you to do it in such a way that when you can expire caches programmatically from a bunch of different locations. It supports useful variable types like sorted sets, which we use very, very heavily at SimpleReach. And you have to pay a serialization, deserialization price on every access, which is something that you need to keep in mind. It's also one of the reasons why the increments on Redis are not quite as fast for us as the increments on Mongo. So InfiniDB and InfoBright, those are MySQL column stores. They're great for analytics, for ad hoc queries in SQL. The database is built for business intelligence, so it's one thing that we don't have to build ourselves. There's no reinventing the wheel there. It's got heavy compression of data, which is anywhere from 10 to 1 to 40 to 1 data compression. So we're storing our data already 2, 3, 4 times. One time in Mongo, one time in MySQL, you know, partially here and there in Redis, and a couple of times depending on the replication factor in Cassandra. So the more compression we get, and even though storage is cheap, the more compression we get, the better off we tend to find ourselves. It also does data pre-aggregation. So if you're interested in some business intelligence, I know there's some sponsors outside who are doing that stuff as well, so I don't want to short sell what they're doing, but the way we decided to do things, you can take a look at the way pre-aggregation works. In MySQL InfoBright, it stores things, it indexes vertically as opposed to horizontally like normal MySQL or Postgres. Our main languages of choice are Ruby, Node.js, and Python. So to us, polyglotony doesn't actually only apply to the data stores. We use multiple languages because our use cases for different parts of our systems are actually different and therefore require languages that are more effective at each piece. So I'm going to get in a little bit more of that in a minute. So each language has its own benefit to each storage layer. For Mongo, we use Node.js because Node.js, JSON, BSON, I talked about it a little bit. It's actually incredibly fast. And because it talks native JSON, it makes things incredibly easy for us. We also use each language for its individual benefits. So Python is really good at offline jobs. We have a data science team at SimpleReach where they use NumPy and SciPy, and anything that they use can talk JSON or can talk to any one of the other APIs. Ruby, as anybody who programs Ruby knows, is incredibly fast to develop in, and although it's maybe not performant enough for our standards for many of the tasks that we do, again, it talks to all of the APIs, it's performant enough for quick development, and it speaks JSON. The problem is that choice isn't always rainbows and unicorns. Choice can actually put you in a bit of decision paralysis. It can put you in a predicament if you make the wrong choice based on maybe a gut feeling or if you're not entirely sure, you know, what all the tools that you're dealing with. There are cons to looking at some of these tools. So Redis can only utilize a single core. And the problem with Redis only utilizing a single core is that if you have one of these AWS instances that has four or eight cores, and you only have Redis on one of them, you're going to peg that core, and the rest of the machine's going to sit idle. And these are one of those use cases that Amazon loves, because you're paying for a machine that you're not really getting. So in our case, what we did is we chose to take an eight-core machine and run seven instances of Redis on it. Because those seven instances, we divide up the memory, we leave the eighth core for the operating system, and we get fantastic performance. The MySQL column store, the con is that the deletes and updates are very expensive to do. And when you have a table with tens of millions of rows and you try to run a delete or an update on it, sometimes those deletes or those updates can take an hour, 2 hours, sometimes even a couple of days. So the idea of being able to run those queries is not always possible. Cassandra also presents its own problems. You know, Cassandra has no B-tree indexes. Those of you guys who are here probably know why Cassandra works well for you and why it doesn't. But the fact that it has no B-tree indexes was a bit of a problem for us, which is why one of the reasons we had to use MySQL in order to do some of those ranges and display some of the analytics that we provide. The biggest problem that we had with Mongo is that queries slow down as your shard count increases. Mongo uses a scatter-gather method of acquiring data across the shards. So it reaches out to, it uses the master as the coordinator, and then reaches out to every single node if it needs to talk to every single node, every single shard rather, asks for every single shard, and then has to process every single shard's response. So if you have 10 nodes, that's 10 threads that have to be spun up on the master just to make that one query. If you have simultaneous queries happening, it's very easy to DOS your master. So if you're using Cassandra, you know that the coordinator method that's used there is actually much more efficient using Bloom filters. Again, this is knowing what the data stores do and are capable of. Python, white space is a bit of a personal issue, especially amongst the developers at SimpleReach. And the community is a bit of a problem. It's one of those things where it's a little bit of a personal decision, but again, all of these decisions that you have to make are personal decisions and they will affect your organization. Ruby is another great tool for us. It's been fantastic for developing things quickly. You can iterate on things very quickly in Ruby, but the fact is that for what we do, it's just not high performance enough. It works for our front end, it's great for displaying the data, but it just does not perform the data science things that we need fast enough, which is why we shifted over to Python. JavaScript is, again, it works great for us on the edge of our network. It handles all of the high concurrency stuff, but it's just not good for I/O intensive workloads for some of the crypto that we have to do here and there. And it's not good on CPU utilization either. So how did we tie it together? Well, first off, we built it in the cloud. We use AWS, as I'm sure most people do. Again, quick for iterating. We built a service-oriented architecture, which I'm going to talk a little bit more about in a bit. We built an internal API. So in order for anything in our network to talk to anything else in our network, it has to go through this internal API, because the internal API for us knows where to get at all the data that the request is making. We also had to build Helenus. Helenus is the Cassandra Node.js driver. It is what we believe should be the standard, and I know DataStax is working towards that as well. The biggest problem that you're going to find if you take the approach that we took is that your data accuracy across your data stores may become a problem. So the way we handled that was we built a lot of programmatic checks and a lot of visual checks. We built screens in our front end to make sure that we could see the values in different data stores of each of what we would see a particular content item. So if we were to open up a URL, we would say, hey, what does MySQL say is the number of tweets for this URL for this hour? What does it say the number of likes is? What does Cassandra say the number of likes is? And as long as those numbers all agreed, we knew we were in good shape, and we knew all of our batch processing was happening correctly. But screens like this were invaluable to us just to make sure that everything was happening the way it was supposed to. We also built a framework for testing storage engines. If you saw before that I had InfiniDB and InfoBright were both up there. They're both MySQL column stores. So in order for us to decide which one of those two were going to be the best for us, we actually made a comparison framework. We put them side by side, and anytime a request was made of the internal API to say, I want something from the analytics database, the query would be run in parallel on both of those machines. We always returned from, on both of those storage frameworks, we would always return from InfoBright, because that's just a decision that we made. And then we would store a hashed version of the query in Mongo along with the query return time. This way we can go through, create a graph, see how long the general return times were of the queries, and see what the most performant storage engine was for our data set. And then once we were done and we made our decision, which we just recently made and chose InfoBright for our workload, we just pulled InfiniDB out and we have a working, we have a fully working data store. And it required no extra workload other than terminating that instance. So what does our architecture look like? This service architecture is everything sits behind the internal API. We have a real-time Cassandra cluster and an analytics Cassandra cluster. InfiniDB is, as I said, gone, and it's just InfoBright there. Redis is our caching engine, amongst other things, and we have MongoDB. But again, in order for anything to hit our infrastructure and request data, it has to go through this API layer. Well, why did we build Helenus? We built Helenus, and actually, the guy who built Helenus is sitting right here in the front row. He's going to be giving you guys a lightning talk later on today about one of the reasons, one of the use cases that it works so well. We built Helenus because we needed a Node.js driver for Cassandra that supported the Thrift API. We needed to support composite columns, which the driver at the time didn't. And we needed it to be able to do, we needed it to be fault tolerant. So if you want to take a look at it, there's the GitHub URL there. We needed, again, CQL2 and 3. At the time, we just needed CQL2. It's now CQL3 compliant, composite column support, and the Thrift interface. And again, if you want to learn more about it, Russell Bradbury, the guy who wrote it, will be talking about it later this afternoon. So here are the points to consider when you're attempting the polygluttony approach. Data consistency is paramount. If it's not the same in all data stores, one screen on your front end is going to look a lot different than another screen. And clearly, that's not only going to confuse your customers, but it's also going to confuse you. How important is data durability? Well, this is going to be different for different data stores. For us, we know that we can drop Redis at any time, recreate it, and it's not really a problem. We can recreate it from any number of scripts or any number of different calls to the data stores, all happening through the internal API. You also have to manage many servers. The way we chose to do that is with Chef. We did it with Amazon, and we actually wrote a gem called AWS CSSHX, which sits on top of Cluster SSH. We all use Macs in-house, so Cluster SSH is a Mac application and allows you to SSH into a group of servers at one time, pops open a bunch of terminal windows, and all the AWS gem that we wrote allows us to do is SSH to security groups. You can SSH to anything in a security group and make changes to everything in a security group all at the same time. Sometimes that's easier than doing things through Chef when you're testing to see if stuff works. The other problem that this could present is you and your team are going to have to learn a bunch of different applications, how to tune them, different programming languages if they don't interface well. And this could cause a headache, especially if you have to develop and distribute something quickly. The turnaround time for that may be a little slower. So what did I tell you? Polygluttony is actually not a sin. A lot of people really feel like having multiple data stores is really asking for trouble. But the fact is, at least for us at SimpleReach, we found that you can't just have one data store and that be the answer. You need to provide multiple ways to get at your data, even if the data is the same across your data stores. Some data stores are just better at running certain types of queries than others. You really have to know your data read and write patterns to do this. We all know that Cassandra writes really, really fast. So for us, that was really key. But because the reads and the way that we do our reads don't work as well with Cassandra, we chose to store the data in Mongo. We store it in Redis. We store it in MySQL. It's just dependent upon which part of our application is asking for the data at any particular time. But in order to really come to that conclusion, we had to know the tools available to us. So the team at SimpleReach did a whole bunch of research. We looked into a lot of data stores. We looked into a lot of the programming languages and decided what would be the best approach. And that actually involved a bunch of folks learning a new language, learning new data stores, learning new tools. But it actually worked out to be the best decision that we could have made. And we also had to know which compromises we were making. Because inevitably, you're going to have to make some compromises because there is no one-size-fits-all tool. If any of this is actually interesting to you at all, because I know it's interesting to us and our team, we're hiring. If you have any questions about it, come talk to me. Come talk to Russ in the front. Any of us could answer any of your questions. We're wearing SimpleReach T-shirts. That's the cool startup thing that you get for working at for working with us. Like I said, if you have any questions, feel free to let us know. I got some time for questions if anybody has any.
You talked about going through pre-scale phase and then, you know, having a transition to scale. So based on the experience that you've been through, would you say you need to anticipate all that scale?
Sure. So the question he asked was, do you need to figure out the tools that are good for scale up front, or do you work your way into it? The advice that I would give you is that you should work your way into it, because you don't know if the exact iteration of the product that you're working on right this moment at that with these tools is going to scale or it's going to succeed. So first work on the success part, and then let the fact that you need to back into other tools be the byproduct of your success. We were successful on Mongo for quite a while. Just Rails, just Mongo for quite a while. That eventually started to break down when we started getting, you know, tens of millions of events a day. And then as that number started to grow and grow and grow, we just found ourselves overloading the Mongo master too quickly. And Mongo is great for what it's good at, but we didn't know where that tipping point was. Once we learned where that tipping point was, we found that we needed a solution for fast data ingestion and high volume data ingestion, which is then we looked around to solve that problem, and that's how we ended up here.
You talked about the consistency across multiple data stores.
Yes. Okay, so we freak out. Yeah, so the questions he asked were, how do we do our data consistency checks? What do we do when something is wrong? And what was the third one? Sorry. And how do we prevent it? Well, the fact is that preventing anything like that is just like preventing any other bugs. Like, the best thing to do is write tests. But realistically, in a startup, when you're iterating quickly, it's incredibly hard to write tests, incredibly hard to write tests efficiently and think down the line. So the way we do it is we make our best effort, we go the first time around, and we do a lot of visual inspection. We do visual inspection of what we believe would be the edge cases. So if the edge cases are correct, we tend to believe that the normal cases are correct. And the way we, given our data set, determine what an edge case is we look at viral articles. So we figure that an article that gets maybe, you know, 1,000 likes or 500 likes, a couple hundred tweets, that's a normal case. But something that gets 50,000, 75,000 likes, you know, a couple thousand digs, a couple hundred LinkedIn shares, you know, 25,000 tweets all over the course of 10 hours with 750,000 page views, that's an edge case. That means that all of that stuff is happening to all of our data stores all at the same time. That's the edge case that we look at. And we know if we get that right, that the stuff happening slower, because we all have to process all of the events that we see chronologically for that event set, so the URL, we know that the edge cases mean that everything else is working well. When we see something wrong, we just have to trace things back. And tracing back, not gonna lie, big pain in the ass. I mean, you start out at the front end, you see what happened at the front, you see what happened in the next write, you see what happened in the move from to the next data store, you see what happened in that calculation. We've got a lot of logs. We do a lot of logging. And that's actually a lesson that we're in the process of learning. We actually haven't figured it out. How are we gonna handle all that log data? We're looking into things like Splunk and Sumo Logic, but again, handling all that log data is extremely difficult. Him and then you.
Speaking of the consistency, what kind of a time are we talking about between data being ingested and it being available on across everything? Worst case scenario, what do you work toward? What's the goal there?
So the goal is actually different for different aspects of the system. For our analytics, where you can actually mine your data, we'd say it's about 2 hours. Because we want to have the ability to say, are we sure? Are we 100% positive? We add a couple of extra data checks. We do some data science-y type things where we, you know, we check ratios, we check proportions, we do accounting type checks. We give a little bit more of a buffer in there just in case things do go wrong. We can catch it before it gets written to the final data store. In that particular case, final data store, which is MySQL, and then we can't do deletes or updates on it. So we do have a little bit of lag time in there that we've built in for ourselves. But in terms of the other data stores, almost everything is instantaneous. And when I say instantaneous, I mean somewhere in the ballpark of 15 to 30 seconds. Everything is done with queuing and auto-scaling. Everything happens, gets pushed onto an offline queue, which we use rescue for very, very heavily. It's all event-based, all trigger-based. And when the trigger happens and things get moved to the different data stores, we buy ourselves time to get to that final point. Yeah, last question? I think the guy disappeared. Ah, cool.
Okay, so you mentioned that you switched to Cassandra for the high writes, and then still you're using Mongo for a lot of reads, correct? So how does Mongo keep up with all of those writes? Still you have to replicate the data.
So Mongo and Cassandra don't actually store the same types of data. Okay. So Mongo we use primarily for our ORM, our front-end ORM, which has our users, our accounts, and it handles all the real-time scores, all the real-time data. And the real-time data is mostly incremented. So anything that's happening in terms of increments, Mongo, in our sharded format, can handle anywhere between 75 and 100,000 increments a second. Whereas we're not writing full data, whereas with Cassandra, we're writing full data and then processing full data sets. So that distinction gives us quite a big breadth in terms of how much has to happen, how much has to be read and ingested on the Mongo side.
So what's the ratio of the size of Cassandra?
He asked what the ratio is in terms of the size. So our Cassandra cluster is about 5 terabytes, growing at about 20 to 30 gigs a day. And Mongo itself is only about 35 or 40 gigs, but we cycle that out. We delete data older than 30 days in order to keep the shards sanely sized and in order to be able to keep our data set in memory, because having your data set in memory in Mongo is critical to its performance. Thank you very much.